Dear Chairman, dear colleagues, many thanks to the organizing committee for the invitation. It's really an honor for me to be here once again in this beautiful country. To the best of my knowledge, there are no data and literature regarding the best anesthetic approach for this patient, for CVAR patients. So in the next 10 minutes, I am going to show you our anesthetic management for these patients. And I would clarify from the early beginning that these patients are patients with high risk for open surgical repair. They are usually geriatric patients with several comorbidities. They usually have an ISA 3 and more. And they undergo a complex endovascular aneurysm repair that should be considered a high risk procedure according to the American College of Cardiologists and American Heart Association guidelines. So this is very important. First, to have a pre-anesthesia assessment for these patients. Here you can see our pre-anesthesia assessment office at least 2 weeks before in order to be prepared in appropriate way and have optimized clinical status. And second, it's very important that there must be an anesthesia expertise on vascular surgical procedure, not only to be able to manage the comorbidities of these patients, but be able to manage a conversion to an open procedure if required. Here you can see in this photo my colleagues. I'm very proud of them. And 1/3 of them are expertise to vascular surgical procedures. And talking about safety, it's very important, the protection from ionizing radiation, which is very huge in this kind of procedures. And as you can see here, on green there is an nurse anesthetist, and on red is another anesthesiologist. They all wear aprons, thyroid shields, and you can see protective screens and in an effort to protect them from the ionizing radiation. Here we can see this wall for our anesthesiology team. And always there is an effort to maximize the distance from radiation source too. Now, the main goals from our anesthetic plan is to provide hemodynamic stability and preserve perfusion to vital organs, including brain, heart, spinal cord, kidney, and splenic vessels. To avoid imbalance in myocardial oxygen supply and demand, I would like to remind you that 2/3 of these patients had the coronary artery disease. To maintain intravascular volume in an early identified and managed clinic, this is very important, and I'll talk later about this. To maintain normothermia, another important issue. To avoid renal failure due to increased risk of contrast-induced nephropathy, high fluoroscopy time and dose of contrast used, to pararenal stents, and to sudden blood loss shock. So we have to take measures to protect renals, like prehydration, reduce fasting time to minimum before surgery, limited contrast load, adequate intratoperative hydration, we always measure cardiac output, and avoidance of any nephrotoxic medications. Regarding type of anesthesia, general anesthesia, of course, is the choice for these patients. Are we talking about lengthy procedures? And in the majority of patients, both upper extremities are employed. Breath holding of the ventilator is easy and can be prolonged if necessary to improve the image quality. This is very important for you. And yes. And with general anesthesia, we avoid any hematomas, as many of patients are on depleting medications preoperatively and will definitely require heparin intraoperatively. Blood pressure control is easier. And if aneurysm rupture occurs during the procedure, the patient's airway is already secured. Now, regarding monitoring, except the basic monitoring, which include electrocardiogram, pulse oximetry, non-invasive measurement of arterial pressure and capnography, as you can see here, we always insert an arterial catheter in the right hand in order to have a continuous monitoring of arterial pressure. We measure frequently hemoglobin, glucose, lactate, and coagulation. And frequent check of ACT, as Dr. Kouvelos mentioned before, at baseline, 3 minutes after heparin, and then every 30 minutes thereafter. ACT should be maintained at 2.25 times the baseline, approximately between 200 and 250 seconds. We also measure urine output hourly, core temperature. We insert two large pore venous accesses in the right hand, and set the venue success. This is mandatory for us as we're talking about high-risk procedure. And we use cerebral oximetry in all our patients because we want to detect not only the embolies that are very usual in this kind of procedures and may compromise the cerebral function, but we use this monitoring as for continuous measurement of hemodynamics, especially at these times that we have both upper extremities employed and we don't have the ability to measure the arterial pressure. With this monitoring, we have an indirect measurement of cardiac output, arterial pressure, and hemoglobin too. Here you can see two different patients, and we try to be upper the baseline values. As we cannot estimate blood loss, because and there is significant blood loss, because blood loss is not in sections, and blood loss is usually between coverings, as you can see here. You can notice the regular flow of blood on the ground floor in this picture, or blood loss is between surgeon's feet or under this table. We have to go around the operating table and identify early the blood loss and manage the hemorrhage too. Finally, hypothermia is a big issue for us. And there is hypothermia due to the almost total body exposed to the cold environment. And there is no possibility to put an underbody air-forced warming device blanket, as we have problems with the image quality. So there is need to warm the operating theater at least 22 degrees. And we use air warming devices between the legs of a patient and, of course, intravenous fluid warmer. With all these measures, this anesthetic management, we are able to extubate patients on the operating table. And after the procedure, all patients undergo by us, the anesthesiologist, at least 24 hours of close surveillance. So in conclusion, ladies and gentlemen, we're talking about high-risk procedures and high-risk patients. And we believe that there must be an expertise anesthesia team. General anesthesia is the best choice, of course, for these patients. There must be an adequate monitoring, frequent ACT measurements, and cerebral oximetry is a very useful monitoring for these patients. We have to early identify and manage blood loss, prevent hypothermia. With all these measures, we are able to extubate patients early on the operating table. But I think that for the great outcome, there must be established a great teamwork. Thank you very much for your attention.